Hi, I'm Frank Gladstone, the executive director of Asifa-Hollywood, and today we're with we're talking about trash truck. And today we're with Angie Sun, Glen Keane, the new person on the block, and Max Keane. Angie is the creative producer. Max and Glen are the executive producers of this new Netflix show, which we're going to talk about. But before we say hi to everybody, I'm going to show a little preview. So if you hang in a second, I'll share screen, and here we go.
Look at that.
Yeah.
Trash truck. Everyone, I want you to meet Trash Truck. He only talks in Chuckese, but I can understand him. Nice roar. See his eyes? Those are headlights. They light up. We've been buddies for a long time.
Two more lines.
Until the last, until we finish the whole season. Come on, Trash Truck. Wait a second. Guys, this isn't broken. It's Hypeen's rocket arm.
Oh, yeah, I knew that.
Hey, Johnny, you're coming?
We are great garbage men. Maybe the best ever. Hey, Walter! Walter, check this out!
Nice.
I know, right? Who would throw this out? A king? We need Walter.
Hey, guys. What are you doing?
It's that time of year again. Hibernation day.
I don't want to hibernate. If I hibernate, then I'll miss out on all the fun stuff you guys are doing.
What? Yeah, Walter. What are you talking about?
Well, last year, you ate fried pickles without me.
Those were so good.
Hey, guys.
Hey, Olive. Treasure wants to dance ballet.
He wants to dance ballet?
Olive knows how to dance ballet.
Yeah, I do.
And rainbow arms. Two, three, four.
Oh, cool.
Isn't it awesome?
Hi, Miss Mona.
Yes, love?
Can you teach us how to make music?
I'd love to. All right, let's get started. Trash Truck, why don't you give us a simple beat?
Trash Truck is an instrument.
Let's do something awesome.
Yes.
Yeah, like an adventure.
Ah, we're going to have some fun today.
That's mighty cute. That's mighty cute. So there you go. So hi, everybody. Max, how did, I think you initially came up with the idea. Is that correct?
Sort of. I mean,
maybe you and Henry came up with the idea.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. It definitely was Henry's idea. My son, when he was like 1.5, he was obsessed with garbage trucks. He would wake up from a nap. I'd have to drive him around, so he would take a nap and he'd wake up from the back of the car, just sit up and go, trash, trash. And it was like this obsession that was always on his mind, even just the word trash. And when we'd take a walk down the street, he'd have to like flip over every single trash can lid. And whenever a garbage truck would pass by, it was like this big explosion of excitement. And so from then on, our whole family was like rallying around this weird obsession that he had with garbage trucks. And I started to feel like, wow, this is kind of a weird thing. Like, how deep are we going to go with this? And we would pull up like garbage truck videos and we'd watch them on YouTube. And I started to see that there was like millions and millions of views of these garbage truck videos. And then I realized, oh, there's a ton of other parents and families just like ours, where they're all, yeah, same. Yeah, and they're all.
It was trains actually for us.
It was what?
Trains.
Train, yeah.
Yep.
That's funny.
Yeah.
I talked to other people because I would talk to other dads. I'm like, man, is your kids go crazy for garbage trucks? And they would say, no, like trains was the other one that I heard a lot of, trains and garbage trucks. But yeah, so it was just like this thing of finding that, oh man, there's all these other families that are just rallying around their kids' love for them. And I didn't get it. I was like, I don't know what his fascination is with it. Tried to like think psychologically about it. Like, what is it? It's like taking something from the house and then it's like dumping it. And I couldn't piece it together. And I was sitting, it was like early one morning and the garbage truck was coming down the street and I was holding Henry and it was this like cool foggy morning in LA. And I could see the lights flashing down at the end of the road. And as the truck like rumbled up and it pulled in front of us, and I saw it had these big like grimy hoses and these cool giant shapes and big, you know, heavy duty welding of metal. And it was noisy and had flashing lights, and it grabbed the trash and dumped it down. And I stood there holding Henry. I'm like, man, yeah, Henry, I get it. This thing is awesome. And then it rumbled and drove away and let out a little honk.
Speaking of rumbling, how did you get those really cool rumbling sounds for the truck? Is there any, did you have to get a special sound effects package, or?
Max knew that I'm somebody that loves sound effects. I mean, I've never been able to sit very long without making a sound effect of a honk or something like that. So he asked me to be Trash Truck. And I think you also mixed mechanical noises in amongst what I was saying, right, Max?
Yeah. Maybe we added mechanical sounds, but there was talk early on of altering Glenn's voice for the Trash Truck, but then, you know, after we heard it against picture, was like, no, you don't need to do anything to this voice, and we'll just add some Trash Truck mechanical sounds. But
back in the day when Glenn and I were both at Disney, we used to talk about Glenn and say he was always talking trash. So I made that up. Sorry. I apologize. We have an interesting comment here, and I want to read it. It's a little long, but it's very interesting. I'm going to read it to you. From Randy Mills. I remember being very young and thinking I could use an umbrella to float off the second floor of our barn. I learned that lesson very quickly and painfully. Thought it was brilliant the way you presented the lessons in this episode. The mouse was teaching pure science, and although it was somewhat advanced and seemed to fly right over their heads, it encouraged them to explore and experiment. Flight lesson with Grandpa was a simpler approach to explaining the same problem, ultimately encouraging them to solve the problem on their own using their imaginations. Beautifully written. Will this method of teaching using more advanced scientific explanation followed by an example be a recurring theme throughout the series? As an animator and expecting father, congratulations, Randy. I can't wait to share this with my son. How about that? Pretty good. So are you going, is there a science, Angie, since you're the kind of the buffer zone between these two crazy people and you're the creative producer, is there a science? Because in this one, there certainly was in this episode, you know.
It's funny, I mean, Max wrote this, and so many of the characters in the world kind of already existed in Max's head when, you know, I first came onto the project. It was like, they already had a world and they were already living there. And we were just trying to tell their story. But from very early on, I think Max, he very humbly said that he is really not the right person to be educating anybody on anything. And the story is really about these characters and what they feel for each other and friendship. And but I do think Miss Mona is that really smart character who is always trying to give them a solution, and sometimes they listen.
Right, and sometimes in this particular episode was, oh dear, you know, yeah, let's put cardboard wings on that trash truck. We're gonna do great. So it was pretty great. Little kids love big machines and trains and trash trucks and all that kind of stuff. But there's animals in here. There's two talking, there's three talking animals. And how did that come about? Why wasn't this these other talking machines maybe or something else? How did the idea for animals to enter this?
I always liked having talking animals. I like just the classic sort of idea of having these like animals that this little boy plays with and they talk and they're his friends. And I also love that Trash Truck was kind of part of that group. And early on when Angie and I were figuring out what is this idea about a little boy's best friend is a garbage truck, I didn't want to make it be like a vehicle show where it's all about like talking vehicles, but I really wanted to make it be about friendships. And I felt like if we're gonna put animals and other types of friends, I didn't want to put other kids because it felt like that kind of breaks this like magic imaginary space that Hank the little boy goes and plays in with these friends, and that all those animals would kind of reflect something about Trash Truck. Obviously a bear loves trash, and so does a raccoon and even a rat. And then growing, well, my wife and I had a rat when we were first married named Miss Mona, and and we had some rats growing up, like some friends of ours. And whenever we go camping, there was always like some bear or raccoon activity. So the location of being like Southern California, these like dry grassy hills, all those things kind of felt like puzzle pieces that fit nicely.
Hey Glen, do you remember back in the studio at Disney, I think one of the departments had a rat named Vanessa. Do you remember her? And they let the cage open and she would visit everybody every day.
No, I don't remember that. Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't. I walked in one day and Vanessa was sitting on somebody's desk. Anyway, that was a long time ago. So I want to talk a little about casting the show. And I want to ask a question. I'm going to start with you, Glen. When you were a kid, you were Billy in your dad's comic strip, Bill Keane's Family Circus. And a pretty terrific comic strip. Jeff is doing it now. I think your brother's still doing it, right? Yeah. And Jeff was in it, and your sister was in it, Dolly was in it, and your mom was in it. And it was a family, and your dad was taking the information from you guys. I think you were a common, you have another brother, Greg, right? Was that?
Chris.
Chris.
Yeah.
You were like Billy was like you guys. Did that idea come, Max, from that past history? Or was this just, I got a great voice that I happen to know and he'll work for, you know, small money
here? Yeah, out of just family obligation, you can't say no. No, and that was just purely because of the relationship that I see that my son has with his grandpa and the relationship that I had with my dad. Growing up and just seeing how comfortable and warm that relationship is between Henry and Glen. And growing up, whenever my dad would tell me stories, there was lots of sound effects and it was engrossing and fun. And it was like, it was somebody being a kid, you know, or like holding on to being a kid. And I really wanted to have that kind of like quality to Trash Truck, where it's almost like there's something warm and caring and almost parental, but they're still childlike. And so I thought, like, I'm not going to find anybody better than my dad.
How's it working directing your son, your daughter's in, not in this first episode, but she's going to be in other episodes. And if we saw her in the cut, in the little cut at the beginning, how is it, here's an interesting question. How is it directing your kids versus directing your dad? Or is it much the same?
Directing my kids is way harder. Well, I don't know. Angie was there for every one of those records and she and I would put together what we came up with like our whole own crazy system of having to do records where we made something called the board script, right? And it had all these images.
Yeah. It was such a crazy experience. Well, I'll just say that I think seeing Max direct Henry and Olive and Glen is a real education in how to be a great dad. Because he, you know, his goal in those records was not, I'm going to get this line. But he was engaging Henry and trying, and they were really, you know, working together and collaborating. And you know, just that Henry did, you know, almost 60 hours of records over the summer, and that he got through it. He was so amazing, really, and Olive too. And yeah, I was like, wow, this is how to parent. Yeah.
Yeah. There you go. Well, I guess there's some lessons learned in the family structure as well. So that's pretty good. Your mom is in a couple of these. Was she not your mom? Who is the voice of the? Is your sister? Is your sister in this?
No, it was just my dad and my kids and my wife.
Oh, and your wife. That's what it is. Megan, right? Yeah.
Megan.
She's the jet pilot and I guess the mom, right? Saying, come back, it's dinner time. You know, that's pretty great. We had I had a couple questions because this is a big production. You're doing 12 episodes for this first season. Yeah, something like that. Glenn's trying to finish up a feature at the same time. Did that bump together at all?
No, I don't. I mean, maybe for Glenn it did, but for me, somehow these pieces work themselves out. I mean, this is like a testament to just having an amazing crew and production teams who could like maneuver. Glenn's schedule is packed, and so any time you could get with him, it really went a long way, and production was able to find really just clever ways of being able to utilize any free time he had to give to Trash Truck. And so I didn't really feel it, but I'm sure other people did.
Did you feel it, Glenn? Did you feel, you know, push and pull because you were trying to get Over the Moon done, I suspect?
Yeah, I mean, a big part of the success of this film was Jenny Rim as also a executive producer on the show. And she was the producer of Over the Moon. So there was a common interest on both projects. Both projects are our babies, you know, that we really, really cared. And we were the first projects that Netflix, as a new startup studio, animation studio itself, the first two landed there was Over the Moon and Trash Truck. And Max is on the third floor, we were on the fourth floor. And, you know, there was a lot of communication back and forth. And I mean, it's just amazing that in 1 month time, both films came out on Netflix. You know, 1 month ago, Over the Moon, and now today, Trash Truck.
So Angie, this is a family affair, you know? Suddenly you get a phone call over coffee, get an introduction. How did that happen?
Well, Jenny Rim, again, who's like the magic maker here, she brought me in very early on just to meet Glenn and Max and said, oh, maybe you should talk to Max about his story idea. And, you know, what existed there, like I was saying earlier, was a very fully formed idea. And we were just trying to put a structure to it. And yeah, that was an amazing experience because we were very much, you know, almost in a vacuum, like we were like a garage band. And I think that's part of the, you know, what makes Trash Truck awesome is it was really incubated kind of in Max's head, you know, off on his own, really just trying to tell the story as honestly as he could. And there's something about Max's way of telling stories that there's a scrappiness to it. You know, he's very, he has a lot of grit and he will just go and figure it out. You know, we've never done any of this before, but he really was like, I'm just going to figure it out. I remember one of the first stories he came up with, we were like trying to figure out some ideas and he's like, I'm just going to go to the park. And he went to the park with like a little notepad and came back maybe an hour later with a whole sequence just thumbed out. It was the hide and seek episode. And that is now, you know, I think it's the fourth episode in the first drop. But yeah, I learned from this family literally every day that I worked on this project. It was the best experience I've ever had. So yeah, go Max.
Well, it definitely goes both ways. And we just could not have made this project without Angie. I mean, she came in and she really gave it exactly its identity and what it needed to be, I think, successful and to find the right people to connect it to. And it was such a partnership between, here's an idea, I'm not sure what it is, and Angie has the ability to kind of like see through the woods and go, oh yeah, no, it should look like this. And this is how we can really like mine the gold out of it.
They would be writing at the same time on the same script. I remember Max, you showing me on your computer and you're writing and I'm seeing Angie words kind of coming in there and sections of the script going away and she's writing and you're doing the same thing. It was like, I don't know how anybody could do that without like a real mind meld between those two writers, you and Angie. It was really incredible.
Soon you're going to start ending each other's sentences and stuff. the show goes through. So I know that you had instrumental guys in design of the show and character design and all of that. And so I know that that's happened, but you also had to work with a studio and you picked a studio in France. Is it because Glenn, you speak really good French? Because I remember when you were taking lessons and working on Hunchback back there, but how did you find the studio? How did you find this one to work? Because they've done a really spectacular job. We had a question about this coming in just a little while ago. So how?
Yeah, I was doing a presentation at the Roosevelt Hotel for an animation presentation and happened to be Olivier Pinol was there, who has a studio called Dwarf in Montpellier in the south of France. And after I finished that, he came up and Jenny and I and him sat down and had a hamburger and we're just talking and he was expressing, is there some way that we could do something together? So we invited him over to the little studio in West Hollywood. And when we went there, Max was in his office working on Trash Truck. And I remember Olivier standing there talking to Max. Sometimes you just get a sense of what you want the future to be. And I thought, man, I really hope that somehow Olivier and Max make Trash Truck together. That would be really cool. And that just continued to develop as a wish. And then as we tried various different companies, we were looking for the best place to do Trash Truck, and they just did a fantastic test. And so it was very much the quality of that company, because we were really shooting for something that had a Disney feel to it, in terms of like what I was constantly taught was, don't animate what the character's doing, animate what the character's thinking and feeling.
Like Frank and Ali used to say.
Yeah, that's constantly the goal for every animator. And so we went to Montpellier, Angie, Max, and I, and Jenny, and we met with the artists there, and it was wonderful just seeing Max share his love of the show with them, and kind of brushed off a little of his own French in talking with them.
That's right. When you were in France back in those days, the kids were with you. So yeah, there you go. Très bien, mon ami. I have another question here. It says, it's from Ted. He said, how long did it take to make the show? In the screening episode, we don't see how the cast of characters in the Trash Truck become friends. So is there going to be an exposition episode down the road, how they got together, or is it we're just going to go forward?
Angie, do you want to talk about that?
Well, we started pre-production in the beginning or the end of 2017. So it's been over 2.5 years of pre-pro and production. What was the other question, Max?
Is there going to be a show that tells how they found each other?
That's a question for Glenn and Max.
I don't know. I think Angie probably has an opinion on that. But I don't know. I think we like that this world always kind of existed. And it's like we don't have to put sort of like, hey, this is when suddenly he saw it as this. It's just like, this is just a character that's always been alive. And I kind of like that.
Well, it's like your son, like Henry when he was little, who knew why there was a trash truck. Kids do that. They just like them.
Yeah.
Did he have a toy trash truck, by the way? Because we had one in the house here.
Oh my gosh, they're like 30.
That's pretty good. Now, I noticed that the music is really pretty exceptional. It's deceptively simple, and it really works with the show. So tell me how that came about.
Man, we got so lucky. I mean, just, we got so lucky with everybody that worked on it. From Angie to Glenn to just Jenny's like amazing visionary power to kind of take an idea and just will it into reality. And just all the people that came on to Trash Truck to make this show what it is. Paulin Music Group, which is Scott Stafford and Alexis Hart. They did the music for Duet in 2014, I think. And so that was how we met them. And then fast forward to Trash Truck time, and we were really wanting to find somebody who could create this kind of soundscape to Trash Truck that could feel timeless and charming and almost like small and handcrafted, but then could also expand and be something big and cinematic like Trash Truck flying through the clouds. And they just did this incredible job of being able to pull in those, like exactly like you're saying, like it sounds deceptively simple, but they're just amazing musicians who just brought so much texture and credibility to the storytelling and the emotion. Amazing.
Works really great. So I have a couple more questions. First one from Ross. What do you, for each of you, what is the most challenging part of working on the show? Challenging, not fun, challenge. Maybe it's fun too. What do you think?
I'll say that I think the most challenging is the limitation of, and I have to say, you know, Netflix has been so supportive of us with the budget and making sure that we're, we're supported that way. But it is really hard to try to achieve such a big idea on any kind of limit, you know. But I think at the end of the day, that made the stories better. You know, we got to a point where it was like, you can have no more sets and no more new characters. And it was like, okay, Max, we just have to come up with 8 more stories that are basically episodes in a bottle. And I have to say, those are some of my favorite episodes. But that was really challenging, you know, to have to do that while we were making. So yeah, it was like drinking from a fire hose.
Yeah. How about you guys?
For me, I mean, it's an interesting thing. Your son is developing a show, and Max has always had a unique style of drawing. I think it was very important for Max not to exist under the shade of my animation tree, to really plant his own. Mm-hmm. And so I was going to design characters based on Max's drawings. And that was hard. There's certain things that my hand wanted to do. And it's like, and Max would go, you know, I would show him and he'd stand over my shoulder and look at it and go, yeah, no, that looks great, Dad. And there'd be this silence. And I'm like, what? What is it? No, it looks good. What am I missing? Okay, well, and you know, then you would lean in, you start to describe the little things and trying to get his uniqueness into the design of the characters and still be somewhat me at the same time, trying to turn it around and making it animatable. This was the beginning of what, I mean, I'm at a phase now in my life where I may be doing mentoring, but it's really reverse mentorship. I am learning so much from Max. I mean, the fact that he's got this Frank Capra bone in his body somewhere that seeps into every episode is just so wonderful. So I find that I'm learning a lot from him. But anyway, so the designing of the characters was quite a challenge.
Right. And Max, what's your biggest challenge?
Well, you know, it's like wonderful and challenging at the same time. Was just making this show and being a first time showrunner on a first season with everything is a first, was just challenging at every turn. Everything is new and everything is different. And you're having to define all of these things as you're going, like Angie was saying, you are kind of drinking from the fire hose. And so every step you're like, you're building the boat as you're on the water. And that was just challenging. Just every day was kind of like full of new surprises and new things that you kind of had to reconfigure and roll with. And it just like would not have been possible had I not had like a creative partner like Angie with me to be able to be like, that's okay, this will float, we'll get there. Just like, oh, it's never gonna happen. And to have Glen and Angie, you know, I think like the best thing you can have are just the best people around you to keep you supported.
Yeah, we were truly blessed with the best crew, like the best editor, the best board artist, like the best voice talent. We were just,
yeah. We have professional voice actors too. The guy I recognized from The Office, who was the kind of nerdy guy in The Office, and of course your raccoon and your Miss Mona.
Yeah,
they're really excellent actors, and I'm sure directing them was a little bit different than directing Henry and Olive, but that might have been maybe easier to do because that's what they do, you know. In the long, it to me watching it, it looked like everybody was having fun. Now I don't know if that's really true, but I have the idea that everybody was having a good time making this, and then we're going in the single direction. So that's to you guys' credit. The final question I'm going to ask is, what's next? What are you up to next?
Angie,
that's always fun because I think you've got another feature.
I'll probably, before too long, land on exactly what that next project is right now. Jenny and I are playing around with something. I know John Kars, who is also a really important part of Glen Keane Productions, and was also an incredibly important part of Trash Truck. In working on the shots and the animation. I mean, just as he was with Over the Moon, our team is a very cohesive group and we all kind of help each other. Angie's developing another project as well. I don't think we can quite yet talk about that.
Don't talk about anything you can't talk about.
Yeah, and you know, but who knows? I think Max is even just, was it yesterday or the day before, you were just talking about some new ideas for Trash Truck episodes and obviously he's had a moment to breathe and is already thinking about future Trash Truck stuff.
Yeah, I would suspect that there will be some more Trash Trucks coming up. If I have any really good ideas, I'll send them to you.
Please do.
Like yeah. Trash Truck meets a train. Yeah. Anyway, I want to thank you all very much for spending time with us. Angie, Glen, and Max, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure not only talking to you, but watching the show as well. So thanks a lot. And now we're gonna fade out. So bye, everybody. Bye, Asifa. Thanks for being on.
Bye. Today.